Good morning, and welcome to a really fun panel discussion. The title of our session today is Your Data Drowning in a Lake? And I know that all the data professionals who are listening in are kind of nodding going, okay, that's kind of interesting. We have sort of a subtext of what we want to pivot off of that title today, which is I want to explore why AI solutions just aren't working for so many people in the industry and why you're having such a hard time amping it up from where you're at today to getting it to work really, truly at scale. You know, the data plays a role, data management and other strategies are mixed in there, but bottom line, I think we all want to be like the cool kids on the block. We all want to mimic this innovation we're seeing from the heavy hitters that are addressing AI, like Netflix and FedEx and others that are just doing kind of incredible things. And bottom line, you know, what strategies are they using and how do we get to join that innovation party? So hold on, tread water. And if you are drowning in your lake a little bit, we'll throw you life preservers throughout the conversation today. I've got two great experts joining me, and I'd love to have them introduce themselves. John, do you want to lead us off?
Yeah, John Thompson. I'm the global head of AI at EY, and I've been working in data and analytics now for 37 years and have worked across 20 different industries and put in, I guess, about 100 different predictive analytic applications at this point. Written a couple books, one with Shawn, and currently writing another, Data for All. And then a fourth book in the works called the book around causal AI. So great to be here. Happy to be with you.
Good to have you, John. Charna, do you want to introduce yourself as well, please?
Yeah, absolutely. It's good to meet both of you and thank you for the invite. So my name is Charna Parkey. I'm the real-time AI product and strategy leader at DataStax. DataStax just acquired Cascada, my startup, where I was the VP of product previously. So we were building, you know, infrastructure in order to solve some of these problems. But before that, really, the past 16, 17 years of my career was in building AI B2B products across different industries. First, you know, my Ph.D. in digital signal processing, I went to the defense industry and then, you know, did some cool UAV stuff there and then decided to go to startup route and have been sort of doing B2B products since then. So hoping to solve the challenges now that I'm in the provider side of all of the things that I kept running into time and time again.
Cool. Well, both of your real world experiences are certainly going to help move the conversation forward. So just to get us off to a light start, I'm going to ask a huge question. You know, AI is certainly buzzworthy. So are all the conversations that are going on around data and data management. And everybody, as I mentioned up front, is kind of struggling, right? They might get a point solution or an app in the field, but maintaining it and then going on to scale is really hard. So here's the simple part of my question. Is it technology? Is it skill sets of your teams? Is it monetary concerns? Is it a disconnect between corporate strategies? I have like a lot more on the list, but I'll stop there. Charna, do you want to lead us off? Like, what do you see as one of these? Where are the hurdles lying right now?
Yeah, I mean, the answer is yes, it's all of them. But I think in particular, the technology limits all of the rest of it, right? So if we have a misalignment or if there are skill set problems, it's because the technology hasn't met us there yet. Oftentimes, what I've been seeing is that the systems are so complex, right? You've got these massive batch systems. They're trying to go streaming, trying to go real time, but it's built for historical stable data sets, not for relevance with time-sensitive applications and sort of these behavioral predictive decisions. And so what I'm seeing is that if the technology limits the questions that we can answer, then we need to change that and we can follow on with some of the rest of it.
That's cool. I like the when technology limits, right? That's a big aspect of it. So John, we checked technology off that laundry list. Which of the ones or do you agree or where are you at?
Of course, yeah, I think Charna said it right. All of the above is the right answer, but they all have different aspects and different applications and different gating factors. Technology, absolutely, we're not there in many of the technologies in the AI stack. We're certainly not there in causal AI, traditional AI, we're getting there. But I'm going to pick on culture. I'm going to pick on a subset of culture. And I think much of it comes from the fact that the C-level executives in most organizations don't understand it. You know, they, of course, everybody's heard of large language models and generative AI, and of course, ChatGPT is everywhere. You'll get it. You know, the CEO goes to Australia and reads, you know, the airline magazine and comes back, and boy, they're really tearing it up over there at Dow or, you know, Bank of America or wherever. I got to have some of that. So then it rolls down the pipe, and then people come back and say, okay, you can have some of that. It's, you know, a year and $5 million. And they're like, no, I want it tomorrow and I want it for free. And it's just, there's a complete lack of understanding of how this stuff really works and how to deliver it coming down from the sea level. So I think that's a real problem.
John, you stole one of those anecdotes that I've used often giving talks. There's nothing more dangerous than a C-level executive with a magazine in a long airplane flight. You know, they make this instant assumption that they can snap their hands. And I saw it a lot in the early days when we were all talking about data types like Hadoop. Right? Everybody needed a Hadoop. They wanted a bigger Hadoop than the other company had. And they wanted a purple Hadoop because that was their favorite color. And they don't always get the ramifications. And having a good idea or coming back from a business trip with an idea doesn't equal strategy. And I think, you know, going back to the first comment, complexity. And one of the words I didn't hear is traditional infrastructures. Right? That everything kind of, you know, people are just getting their act together on some of these more mundane data management issues. And now when innovation jumps forward towards, you know, real time and AI driven apps, they're all sort of scratching their heads trying to figure out where to get to. Is money, I'll ask this of both of you, is money still playing a big issue here? Or is that sort of taking a backseat to technology and strategy and so on?
I think, yeah. I mean, part of where money is coming into play is that you've already made a bunch of investments from the last 5 years. First, you needed to be collecting all of this event data, and then you needed to be storing it in all of these places, and then you needed all of this stuff on top of it. And so a lot of investment has gone into the space, and it would be a mistake to say that it's all wasted, but it's also a mistake to say that you have to go with traditional, to your point, first. If the problem you're trying to solve is contextual and it needs real-time context, like some of the personalized apps that consumers are demanding right now, why are you building a traditional infrastructure, right? Maybe you need to start real-time and then go back to some of those traditional use cases. So it's a money problem, but it's a money because we're trying to do it so sequentially with the same roadmap for every single company, I think.
The good answer. John, anything on the monetary aspect?
Yeah, I don't see money as being really an issue. You know, of course, I'm talking enterprise class organizations. You know, if you've got three Chick-fil-A's in Cleveland, maybe money's an issue for you. But, you know, if you're an enterprise or mid-sized corporation, money's not really an issue. It shouldn't be an issue. And, you know, you can deliver a great deal of impact with a small team. And one of the things that I saw was a real problem in my previous job was that you'd get it from the IT professionals that, you know, you're not copying this data, are you? Well, yeah, we are copying that data. And they're like, well, we can't have two copies of it. Well, you got 35 copies now. So I don't know why 36 is going to be an issue. And the thing that people really don't understand, and it should be understood by now, but it doesn't seem to be, is that your data management regime needs to take care of your transactional systems, your lakehouse systems, your analytical systems, your predictive, your prescriptive, your simulation, and your optimization. And every one of those layers has a different representation on how the data needs to physically sit in whatever disk format you have. So there's a lot of this, oh gosh, you know, we're going to end up with lots and lots of copies. Well, you are. But to do it the way that we're talking about, if you're going to have all those different layers, you're just going to have different formats and different organizations of data. That's just the way it is. And that seems to be hard for some people to get their head wrapped around.
Yeah, well, and I agree. And you gave me a good segue to the next question I had here on my list to ask today, which is about kind of these hybrid data infrastructures. Everybody's infrastructure is different. Everybody reacted to something different throughout their journey to, and so you find that they have bits and pieces of things that are necessary to kind of meet this kind of cool new demand of the way that we want to do, you know, AI and machine learning. So I'll kind of ask that question. When you look at things like data lakes and big data and event data and streaming data, how's this landscape either fueling the innovation or is it hindering it? Is that, you know, is that at the core of one side or the other? John, where do you sit on that? You know, what today's data landscapes, these hybrid environments?
I think they're great. I think they're really enabling of a lot of flexibility and agility. You know, when it was everything went into the warehouse and it had to be highly curated and validated to six different ways, and it could only get in there if, you know, these three people said yes, that was stifling. That was a real problem. And then we went into the Hadoop environment, the big data environment, where it was all just dump it into the swamp and hopefully you'll use it someday. You know, which that's okay. If you got enough disk, I guess it works. But, you know, what we found coming out of that paradigm was that it is great to have it all. And you really shouldn't worry about structuring it or, you know, hopefully it's of good quality before you dump it in there. But what we've done in the last 3, 4, 5 years is that we take a look at the landscape of all the data that's out there, and then we integrate it and structure it based on the project we're in. So all that upfront of hoping that you would get it right, so someday you might use it, that was all just a waste of time. So, you know, as long as you have the data, and it doesn't have to be in your cloud or in your data center, wherever, it can be in the Bureau of Labor Statistics or, you know, Google or wherever you buy it from, and you bring it together for a specific purpose and you codify and automate those feeds, then you've got a real opportunity to have some agility in your analytics. So I think these hybrid environments are not only good, but they're necessary. And you really need to be thinking inside and outside of your company on what the data, you know, architecture really is.
Charna, you are vigorously nodding. I know you have commentary.
Yeah, I think I summarize that into stop deferring your limiting decisions, or like you can't. Machine learning is inherently a chaotic problem. I can't tell you right now what I'm going to need to know tomorrow. My application itself is going to change. The data I'm going to collect is going to change. The world around me is going to change. So if you stop these decisions from limiting you, then you can kind of unlock the data in the right way. So what John was saying is like, sure, it's fueling innovation, but if you make the wrong choices, you could hinder it. So you don't want to ever say, I'm going to pick this one schema and I'm going to enforce it, because you don't know that that's true. You need to keep things with timestamps. You need to keep the raw data, and then you need to sort of create views of that. And the more and more we can remove the barriers to folks making the views that they need, the better sort of problem solving we can do with the data.
Well, and John said the word, he said agility. Right?
Yes.
There has to be this sort of flexibility in your infrastructure, no matter what your world looks like. It's got to have enough agility to meet the new demands, the new needs, and the evolving needs, to use your point, because I don't know what I want and need tomorrow. And as John said, waiting for 3 months for someone to populate some rows in a relational database and a data warehouse in your infrastructure, that doesn't do what we need it to do. So it has to be, I think, sort of this really cool balance. So like looking at the balance, one of the ideas I see a lot right now is kind of bringing the AI and the analytics closer to the data, not that older paradigm of hauling everything back to a data center. Can you do the analytics in different places inside your applications? Can you bypass which I called traditional data management infrastructures early on? Are either of you seeing it? Do you like it? Are you concerned about it? You know, John, you mentioned that idea of duplication of data within different systems for different uses. Does that help alleviate a little of that if you leave the data inside the app? I mean, talk to me about it from that perspective.
Charna, go.
Oh, I thought he was asking a specific example.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, so for me, part of what you're needing to do when you're bringing AI to the data, especially in real time, is solve some of these latency issues and freshness issues, right? So if you have to take your data and move it a bunch of places, I can't have that data in the application immediately. So we think about in-session activity. How, as I'm watching Netflix, if I've like tried 5 shows and I don't like them and I'm going back to find another one, how does Netflix know to give me something new? I don't want to just keep coming back to the same home screen. I've said no 4 times. So how do I get that data to the ML very quickly? And so that's why we're seeing it come closer and closer together, is so that we can solve some of those dynamic problems in the system. Now, if you don't have that dynamic problem, it doesn't need to be real time. Sure, ship your data off somewhere else. But sure, otherwise, you need to bring them closer together.
John, what do you see in the industry around that idea?
Yeah, well, you know, Shawn, you and I have been talking about this for what, 15 years? We started with model portability way back with PMML and NDAA at Dell and other places. So, I I'm a big believer in models everywhere where models make sense. You know, either running on your television or on your smartphone or on your IoT device gateway, whatever it is. You know, I think that models should be ubiquitous. And models should be giving better performance and better experience to the end users, to networks, to fraud detection, to, you name it. You should be able to get the intelligence out of the large data environments you have, and then ship that intelligence in a codified way, in a model way, in a scoring environment to any node, in any network, to any device where it makes sense.
I agree 100%. And I do think taking the model, taking the algorithms of the data makes it kind of starts to checkmark that agility question that a lot of the more traditional environments are finding a hard time adopting. And it gets down to at the core of this is speed, and speed to insight, speed to action with your customer or over, on fraud or any of these kind of neat use cases that we see equals value. And the longer the speed is delayed, the longer that time band goes. Often, not with all, but often a lot of real-time decisions lose value fairly quickly. Now, in some circumstances, it's sub-second. With other interactions, it could be minutes or a day or an hour. But the bottom line is that if you can't do these things, you can't attain the speed. And Charna, you kind of touched on that, and I'd love you to elaborate, because I think it dovetails into taking a fresh approach and being more agile. I think the speed thing is super important for the value aspect.
Yeah, and there's speed on two sides of the equation, right? There's speed to new insight, new discovery, new model. Yeah. Like, how do I move from a world where today data science and machine learning to me are in sort of the typewriter era? It takes months and months to go from I have a question, I'm answering the question, I've trained a model, I've put a model in production, etc. How do we make that transition from typewriter to Google Docs for machine learning and real-time machine learning? We have to give this sort of instant iteration discovery, and it needs to happen so quickly that they can get that into production when it's still relevant. So maybe that's online learning. Maybe that's some method of having shadow models run at the same time and you can swap them out as the new one is trained in the right way. There are all of these ways that we've been talking about speed, but it does come down to it. I also think though that speed can be risky in some use cases.
It can, so, I agree, yeah. It can. Yeah, certainly. I think the use case is a big part of that little simple math program I just did, right? Speed equals speed and time equal value. But you're right. In certain circumstances, risk plays a role. John, how do you see that from a value standpoint or even a risk standpoint?
From a value standpoint, speed's great. If the scenario that Charna played out in Netflix, if I went back 4 times and I'm getting the same thing, well, that's not very intelligent. But if, you're personalizing it and coming back and saying, hey, you said, no to 4 horror options, maybe you're in a mood for a rom-com or something like that, that's cool. But, not everything has to be in session or in app. You can actually learn and come back, and you can pretty much guarantee that if someone has been a subscriber to Netflix for 5 years, they're probably going to be a subscriber next month. And if you do a better job of personalizing, they're going to recognize that value. So I think the whole idea, speed's good, speed's great, love speed. But the whole idea is continual improvement of the user experience, continual improvement of delivery of appropriate intelligence to the right person at the right time. So speed's good, but I think value can be delivered in a variety of different ways. And you both said it, you know, if you sacrifice accuracy and quality in the service of speed, that's going to bite you probably sooner rather than later.
Yeah. No, I totally agree. The time's going by pretty quick. So I want to sneak two more questions in. One is, share one piece of strategic advice that you see the big successful companies using. You know, so I mentioned, you know, Netflix and FedEx, and we could make a bunch of them that are out there leading the way on this whole, you know, AI-driven application, being smart, being fast, being real-time. What strategy do you see that's out there that differentiates them? And you can't say money, because I know the big ones have a lot of money. So strategically speaking, what comes to mind first? John, do you have a thought out of the box?
Sure. You know, don't go searching for a problem. You have lots of problems. You know, I hear this from people. You know, we got to find something to apply this AI to. You've got a lot of problems, you know, price, distribution, customer acquisition, customer retention. Just take the biggest problem you have and address it. You don't have to keep casting about for some new sexy problem. You know, just address the one you have.
Pragmatic, for sure. Charna? Yeah.
I mean, I certainly like that direction. I guess the other piece of advice I would give is that it took Netflix and Instacart 5 to 7 years to figure out how to go from batch to real time. And they found a bunch of patterns that work. A lot of companies have. You don't need to hire, you know, 50 data engineers, 20 MLEs in order to build your own platform. You can learn from some of these patterns and sort of skip forward in that process. So I guess the other piece of strategic advice, then, if I could summarize it, is once you have that problem, pick the right infrastructure on the right data. You probably already have the right data, but don't choose a piece of infrastructure just because someone has experience with it. Look at the problem you're trying to solve and pick the sort of the right thing that meets that problem.
I like both of those answers. I'll add on top, avoid bright, shiny toy syndrome, which is kind of what you were just mentioning, right?
Yeah.
Don't run off and buy the newest this or that. Take a look at the data, take a look at the infrastructure, and identify where you might have a gap, and then where you can seamlessly affect it or make a change to things to meet the new innovation demand that you're feeling. And I think that's an important carry away for anybody that's making changes to their strategy and their environment.
Yeah.
So I always ask my panelists when I'm done with these things, did I forget an obvious question around this? You know, for all of our friends out there fighting where their data is and what they're doing with it, is there a final comment from either of you that we want to leave everybody with today?
Yeah, don't dump your confidential information into ChatGPT.
Yeah, I've caught that one this week. Yeah, do not put company code in ChatGPT. Thank you.
Oh, no. I can't believe that's happening.
Anything from you?
So same along the route of ChatGPT and others, we're seeing a lot of hype come around. You don't need to be doing the hype ML. You just need to solve your problems, right? So you can use ChatGPT for some things of wordsmithing and stuff, but remember that you still have a churn and retention problem. You still have an engagement problem. So it might be cool to run some campaign with the shiny new hype, but you have some actual sort of classical machine learning issues to solve today. So work on those.
Well, great advice, and a big thank you to both of you for joining me today. I'm going to do 3 more of these LinkedIn Lives in the coming weeks. I hope everybody that's listening will join me. And they're all kind of around this topic of where data and real time and AI applications are all kind of colliding. And the next series I'm going to do, we're going to bring a data science expert into the room and kind of hear that conversation from that perspective. Although I do know that both of my guests have data science backgrounds, but I didn't ask data science-y questions today. So thanks for the insight, both of you, and thanks for joining us, and thanks to everybody for listening, and have a great day.